your family. This is who I was with last week.
Oh, God. Can't get better than that. How cute. How old are they?
Six and, three.
Yeah, it looks like they just stepped in stone.
Yeah, well, they're father and aunt for 3 years apart. Almost to the day.
Yeah.
And they're so much fun.
You know, when Gail's mother was giving birth, they didn't have ultrasound.
Right.
Not in Fort Hill. Gail was born, and then they were pushing her out. Mother, and she said, "Whoa, wait a minute." And of course, the second twin, it was exactly like that. There was no warning, nothing. Yeah.
Thank you, Carol. We appreciate her filling in. She does a fantastic job. Elizabeth is still about a week away from returning, still with a lot of that leftover respiratory thing that's been going around. So, Carol, thank you, and we'll pray for Elizabeth and others during our prayer time. It's good to see you here. It's customary to remember in Methodism, I say, the peace of God be with you. Thank you and bless you. Let's look at the announcements. We do have some new things going forward into the new year. The trustees will meet at 5:30 on Wednesday. And we have started a new Bible study. You can plug in right away. We're studying the highlights of the Psalms. There are all kinds of Psalms, and we're looking at them. And they are a blessing. They really are. And we have discussion around the table, and I love that as much as anything. So we'd love to have you come on Wednesdays at 6:30. And then on the 17th, there is the Finance Committee. I haven't talked to Ed. They may not be meeting. My guess is they will, since it's the beginning of the year. And then the Ad Council at 6:00. We are planning what we did last year, a planning retreat on Saturday, January the 21st. And we invite all of you to come to that, especially if you're on the council, but it's for all of us. And from 10 to 2, we'll go through the church calendar for the entire year and set the structure and the ministries. We'll have interaction and planning. So from 10 on Saturday till 2 o'clock, we'd love to have you join us. As a matter of fact, I think the original time was 10 till 12. 2 o'clock is the max. That was last year's. We got through earlier than that, and I expect to do so again this year. So it will not take all of your morning or afternoon. And then Sunday the 29th, can you believe it, is another fifth Sunday. We've had more fifth Sundays lately than I can remember. So naturally that means our men's choir is going to be singing. I think that the district, the sub-district that normally we meet on Sunday night for fifth Sunday, I don't think we're meeting in January. I haven't heard anything. Sally Flowers, your former pastor, is chair of our cluster, and I haven't heard from her yet. But I'll let you know as soon as that comes about. Other announcements, outside of thank you for all the things that were done at Christmas, we enjoyed every minute of it. We really did. And fortunately, through the devotions I've printed through the years, I have 1,600 people that my Facebook page goes out. And so when I put that picture of the poinsettia tree, I got so much feedback. You're probably going to start seeing poinsettia trees all over the place, but that's a good thing. But they thought it was just most beautiful. Any other announcement? Yes, Carol? John built frame. Yes.
And anyway, so we got it put up, and they take it down. We put the poinsettias on to keep them watered and try to keep them looking good. But to have been up there for 3 weeks pushed together like they were. They held up immaculately.
They did.
They really did.
Yeah, I appreciate that.
It was a unique and remarkably beautiful.
They stayed red, beautiful.
You couldn't walk in the room without lifting your
spirit. I know it. It's beautiful. And to show you how far things have to be planned, Carol's already having to work on the Easter lilies. So you'll be hearing in the future of purchasing an Easter lily in memory or honor of someone. And they too are beautiful in this sanctuary as well. Any other? Okay, let's go to the Lord together in prayer. Oh Lord, you have granted us the wisdom, the knowledge to see a universe that is far bigger than our ancestors ever dreamed. Millions and millions, if not billions of stars, solar systems, light traveling throughout the universe, and here on what some might call an insignificant speck, you have made us. And you have had relationship with us. And so the more we understand of your greatness, the more our understanding of grace grows, that you who made all things would choose to be involved in our life. Lord, that is what drives us to our knees in wonder and the recognition that though we know you in Christ, there is always more to know, always more yet to come. Thank you for this journey that we're taking spiritually, emotionally, in every way. Thank you for brothers and sisters that are taking it with us together. And Lord, we look forward to the day when, as Paul said, now we see through a glass dimly, but then we shall see face to face. Thank you for every gift of revelation. Lord, we thank you for this season of Epiphany as we remember light, revelation, the ability to see you in life. Bless this time together as we move from Advent and Christmas into a season where light shines throughout the world and we acknowledge it. So bless our Epiphany services. Allow us to see them and understand the meaning of Epiphany in a different way that enlivens us as your children. In the name of Christ we pray, amen. Our call to worship, I don't think we did. Elizabeth give you one? Okay, I'll tell you what, we all know the song, This Is the Day. We can sing that twice, so let's just stand and begin with that. Oh, that's what we'll do. We'll do it a cappella. Okay? We'll do it a
cappella. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice, let us rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made.
Now let's sing, Sunday is the day, Sunday is the day, Sunday is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. We will rejoice. Let us rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, Sunday is the day that the Lord has made. Thank you. Remain standing for an old hymn that it's really fitting for Epiphany, as I'll explain again more about the meaning of Epiphany later. But 277, tell me the stories of Jesus. And we'll sing all the stanzas. Tell me the stories I love to hear, things I would have to tell me if we were here. Scenes by the wayside, tales by the sea, stories of Jesus, tell them to me. First let me hear how the children stood round his knee, and I shall fancy his blessing resting on me. Words full of kindness, deeds full of grace, all in the love light of Jesus' face. Into the city I follow, waving a branch of the palm tree high in my hand. One of his heralds, yea, I would sing, loudest Hosanna, Jesus is King. Thank you. Before we do the Apostles' Creed, there's something you can help me out with. We do have people that visit or have been here a long time that do not know the meaning of certain phrases in the Apostles' Creed, and nothing wrong with that. We cannot know unless someone explains it. The word quick, she shall judge the quick and the dead. Quick means living. And I actually had a dear, well-educated friend that thought it meant quick. Quick. It means living. He'll judge those who are alive and those who have passed. And then, of course, the Holy Catholic Church is with a little c. That is an adjective. It means everywhere that there's a genuine faith in Jesus, there is the church. So whatever denomination happens to be, we are one holy family, and that's why we affirm our faith in the Holy Catholic Church. Now let us say together, affirm our faith together with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And we'll do the Apostles' Creed every now and then at the nine as well, is these are the non-negotiable beliefs of the Christian and of our church. These are not up for debate. They have been debated for over 2,000 years. This is the core of our beliefs, shared by Christians all over the world. And I want you to know in your own church that in our book of discipline, these are placed under what's called restrictive clause, which means you can never change them. No matter what other people believe and how it's been abused, they are unchangeable in the book of discipline. And so I take great comfort in that, though we know all the wackiness that seems to be going on in the world, in the church, that we have this foundation that cannot be removed or altered. And so that belongs to you, and we all have a part in making sure that we adhere to that which we believe. Our sharing of praises and concern, let me first ask about just praises. Does anybody have a word of praise this morning?
Well, my brother came home.
Yeah.
We were all shocked in itself, but that's a good time. So yeah. We're rejoicing in that.
Yeah, there's a, in the book of Acts, you know, they're praying for Peter to be released. And suddenly he knocks on the door and they're astounded that he's there. Well, he's the answer to their prayer. What were you praying for? Her brother is like that. We've been praying for him to get well and get home, and then we're amazed that he's there. We're thankful for that. Others?
I got a replacement truck, so I'm very happy.
You do what?
A truck.
A replacement truck.
She got a replacement
truck. Oh, that's my hearing, not your talking. That's great. That is great. Others? Yeah, Sheila?
I heard from a dear friend who I had intended to see on my trip to Illinois that didn't happen last year. And we had a wonderful long talk for probably an hour. Oh. And finally she said, well, how's your weather? And I said, it's bright blue sky, and I think it's 65 degrees. She said, we've had 3 days of sunshine since Thanksgiving. She lives in Illinois, right where I used to live, and it was a treat to hear from her, and it was a chance to glow. Yeah, I have to be in Georgia.
We are blessed in a beautiful part of the country with beautiful weather. We really are. Yes, Don?
Mike Wills' family.
Yes. I saw that also. Molly puts it on our Facebook page as well. And has that funeral already been, or is it coming up? Okay, let's remember that family. Of course, Elizabeth, and we mentioned Gail's brother. I talked to Larry yesterday on the phone. He was finally able to get back with me. And Judy, you got to be careful with the names. Judy is in Lake Park Center in Madison, Florida. Okay, so she's not in Lake Park, she's in Madison, in a place named Lake Park. Larry and them are so relieved. At one time, they thought that she might have to end up in Macon, Savannah. There are no beds. And to find a place that close has been a blessing, and Larry was very thankful. So we pray for he and Judy this morning as he ministers to her. And Larry needs some love and care and prayers himself. Others? Yes, Nancy.
My former sister-in-law and forever friend, Carol Ellsbury, passed away this past week. And I noticed that she's still listed on the homebound. And I thought, how appropriate. Mm-hmm. She is homebound. Yeah. So,
Carol. Yeah, you got to help me.
I
got it. Okay. If not, yeah, I see it under the homebound, just like Nancy said it would be. Okay. Thank you, Nancy. Pray for that family.
Hugh is still not.
Yes, I talked to Hugh on the phone because he does have COVID, he and Erica. And he said, I just can't get over the fatigue. Is that a part of it? And I said, yes. And I said, it will end one day. I just didn't tell him it could take 4 to 6 months sometimes. But he's in good spirits, he and Erica. And hopefully we'll get them back again soon. Others?
Greg and Kathy?
Yeah, Greg and Kathy Lay both have COVID. There's that new strain that's about, and to visit the hospital is a production anymore if you can get in to visit. You always want to call ahead. Other? Yes, Dave?
My daughter Chelsea is in her last 4 weeks of pregnancy and has come down with COVID again.
She has COVID with in her last...
Last month.
My goodness. I'm sorry, Steve. We pray the Lord's healing and strength for her. One good thing, from what I hear, and of course Kurt would know more about that than me, but I don't think it's as deadly as some of the COVID of the past, but highly contagious. And we need to be careful with each other, because what may not be deadly to me, to a person with severe lung conditions who are taking chemo and fighting, it can be for them. So we always want to be careful of washing our hands and putting on masks around people that especially are struggling. Okay. Yes, Sheila.
One more thing. Jerry Carroll, our church secretary.
Thank you.
Has not been allowed to drive for the past month due to a fall that she had 4 weeks ago. And she's having trouble getting communication from the doctor. And she's happy to have a ride somewhere if anybody wants to take her someplace. Sandra and I are being her taxi service these days, which we enjoy. It's not a complaint, but keep her in your prayers. She's very frustrated with the lack of communication and the lack of mobility of just being able to get in her car and go, because she is called Granny Go.
She's very independent.
Yes. Granny Go. So.
She's been having headaches.
Yes.
And is still susceptible to falling. So
yes.
Any way we can help her, please do, because she's going to get up here at all possible and do her bulletins and everything. Okay, if there's no others, let's go to the Lord together in pastoral prayer. Well, Lord, we thank you for the ability to have memory and to be able to see people alive in our mind. Know them so well, we can almost hear their voice when we imagine them. See their faces when we dream and when we call out their name. They are ever present in our mind. And if they can live within us and our prayers, how much more alive are they in you? You know each one so intimately, every detail of their life. You know where they are headed. You have a desire for their life, an opportunity for their life, and a blessing for their lives. So we pray that anything that impedes that, that leaves them weak and struggling, fearful, we pray that you would bring them great comfort and heart, and use your people to strengthen each other. Let us be the smiling face of encouragement and hope. We thank you for the gift of medicine, for all the doctors and nurses and medications we so often take for granted that our ancestors would have loved to have had. Thank you for the gift of knowledge that allows our healing to go forth and to alleviate human suffering as much as possible. We pray for the world and all the places of hatred and brokenness. And Lord, we pray for your holy church. Lord, in a time when your world seems to be in such disarray and so broken, people look to your church for hope. And there they find your people divided, divisive in spirit, sometimes angry. This is not the reflection of Christ in the world. It is not the movement of the Holy Spirit in the world. Oh Lord, heal your church. It is yours. You breathed us into being at Pentecost. You have called us to be the presence of Christ in the world and promised us that even though the gates of hell come against us, we shall prevail. Your church will never disappear. There may be a remnant here or there, but it will always exist and start and grow and emerge. During these troubled times, give us patience and let us have faith in each other, faith in you, and faith in your holy church. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As your pastor, it's my responsibility. I don't talk a lot about the division and the choices here. My role is to preach Jesus and to trust God's people. But as you know, we've been, especially on Fox News, we have been major headlines lately with churches suing churches, blocking things in court. And I think about that and I think, what a poor witness to the world. And I take it seriously, and I grieve. I worry about it every day of my life. Even though I'm supposed to just leave it to God, it's my family, your family, a part of over 40 years of my life, a rich part. What North Georgia did, I do not understand at all. They are a different group of people than we are in South Georgia. And for the bishop to suddenly, it's the bishop that created the lawsuit against the big church that was up there you read about, for the bishop to suddenly change the rules on God-fearing people and saying to them, you can't leave now until this time. Fortunately, South Georgia is very much compassionate with a bishop that seeks to help churches do whatever they feel they need to do prayerfully. Send them off with love if they leave, embrace them if they stay. But when you see those headlines, just bow your head and pray, because there are a lot of people looking at that headline who don't know the church, and we've done not one thing to bring them to it. And so pray. It takes a great toll on me stressfully and on Gail, and that's just impossible not to stop. So pray for us as we work in the church at every level possible. The next chorus is probably perfect. Seek ye first God's kingdom and God's righteousness. There are two verses, the second one, ask and it shall be given. And let's sing both of them, 405. Let's stand. Steve, you can lead us in them. Hallelujah. remain standing for offertory prayer. Lord, there is so much brokenness in the world. And there are places where your church stands on the front line of suffering. Use this offering to make a difference. We entrust you with it to see that it goes to further the kingdom of God. In Jesus' name, amen. Got any children here this morning? Okay, I'm just going to pass their basket. Forget at this service that we don't have the choral anthem or the children's moment at 9 o'clock. So I'm afraid that I ask you to stand again if you can physically. This is the reading of sacred scripture. It is our way of saying that we believe it is holy, ancient, and given of God. Chapter 4 in Luke's Gospel, as we move beyond the Christmas event, in verse 1, Jesus moves into the wilderness. Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, left the Jordan, was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing during those days, and at the end of them, he was hungry. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, tell this stone to become bread." Jesus answered, "It is written, man shall not live on bread alone." The devil led him to a high place and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And he said to him, "I'll give you all their authority and splendor. It's been given to me, and I can give it to anyone I want to. If you worship me, it will all be yours." Jesus answered, "It is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." The devil led him to Jerusalem and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. He said, "If you are the Son of God," he said, "throw yourself down from here, for it's written, he will command his angels concerning you to guard you carefully. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone." Jesus answered, "It is said, Do not put the Lord your God to the test. And when the devil had finished all this tempting, he left him until an opportune time. That opportune time was Gethsemane. This is the word of God for the children of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Many of you don't get the devotions that I write on Facebook. They have some algorithm where they choose who gets to read whose stuff. I don't understand it as of yet. But I wrote there yesterday a story of something that happened to me in a very small town when we were first pastoring. We had a new couple move to town, and she had grown up all her life in the far north. After Christmas, she kept her Christmas tree up for 2 weeks. Now, most of us are in a hurry to get it down. And in a small town, and they were good people, it wasn't gossip as much as it was, I wonder why she won't take it down. Now, I guess that is gossip in some form, but it wasn't intended to be harmful. They didn't understand it. And she caught wind of it. And so she came to talk to me, and she said, I don't understand why people are concerned that my Christmas tree is still up. She said, in the town in which I was reared, we left our tree up until Epiphany. And then we drug them all to a common site in town, and we created a bonfire. And we sang hymns, and we prayed, and celebrated what Epiphany means. The light of God has come to illuminate, to reveal, to show. I can't think of a better way to do it than that. Today you'd have to get a permit to do something like that. But anyway, I'm thankful I heard her share with me that. That was her Epiphany tradition. Epiphany may be the most overlooked season of the church. Christmas we celebrate with tremendous gaiety and so much adornment. And then Epiphany comes, and Epiphany means get your tree down in a hurry, clean your house out, and go back to the ordinary. Epiphany says that that babe in Bethlehem was light and would show us things we had never contemplated or thought about before. Things that not only revealed but ignited the soul. It allowed us to move towards our greater self in God. And this is the first Sunday of Epiphany today. During Epiphany, we normally celebrate the baptism, the circumcision, the baptism, and the temptation of Christ. So let me just first say briefly a moment about what happened at his baptism. How many of you have ever wondered why he needed to be baptized? John is offering a baptism of repentance to be able to be forgiven for your sins, but Jesus has committed no sin. Why be baptized? When Jesus walked into that water, it was the acceptance of being the Messiah for the world. He accepted the ministry of death and resurrection. And that's when the Spirit came upon him. In the Old Testament world, and even into the New, when a new king was coronated, they would take oil and pour it over their head and consecrate them. But Jesus didn't receive olive oil. He received the oil of gladness, the Holy Spirit, which meant he wasn't just king of the Jews, and he wasn't just king of Israel. He was king of the world. And that's why God said, "This is my Son in whom I am well pleased." Now, if I were able to write the events of Jesus and I were thinking, "Oh God, what should be next?" It should be for Jesus to suddenly prove he's the Messiah, that he's God. Do some miraculous miracle when you come out of that water. Instead of proving he was divine, he proved he was like us. Led into the wilderness, the first thing to encounter temptation. And in that moment, he would understand everything we would ever go through and all the temptations we would face for himself. He would know what they felt like. He would know their power, and he would overcome to say to you and me, "So can we. So can we." We have this beautiful gift of temptation. Now you might say, "That sounds strange." Temptation was present in Eden when God made the second tree. That's temptation. Not just to eat of this one, but the possibility of eating of that one. The gift of choice. Of choice. Because without that choice, we are robotic. And every decision we make doesn't matter because we didn't have another decision to make. We have the gift of choice. It's in our spiritual DNA. It's our emotional. It's our physical DNA. We will be tempted. That's a part of our life. Choice is the gift of God we've had from the very beginning. Choose this or choose that. And our life today is the sum total of all the choices we've made in our life and will make in our life in the future. Now, Jesus is led into the wilderness, which in Judaism meant a place where you are alone. There are no crowds. There are no other voices. There's just you and your own soul and God. And there you will wrestle with God, and you'll wrestle with yourself. You'll wrestle with the devil himself. That you may choose that when you come out of that solitude, you are stronger in character, more loving in heart, and clearer in understanding. You see, we may not have a wilderness, but every decision we make is in a wilderness because we make it alone. We cannot say, "They made me choose that. They pressured me to do that. It's my decision." No matter what, no matter what voices are there, no matter what pressure is there, it's my decision to make, and the consequences of that decision are going to be mine. So in that way, the wilderness was a place for Jesus to be led to understand us, because we all are going to stand alone with what we choose. And so here in the wilderness, Jesus faces what we've always faced: temptation, a choice that we have. And notice, we only have three. You could preach forever on every temptation in life and not exhaust it at all. We are tempted to do this and to do this and to do this and to do that. No, this goes to the very root of all temptation. These three temptations capture the very spirit of where choice comes and exactly what we are tempted to do. And they all are found in this one statement. Prove yourself. If you are the Son of God, prove it. Prove it. It's one of the most dangerous traps we ever fall into. Prove it. Carl Jung, the great psychologist, personality theorist, once wrote, "If you don't know who you are by now, the world's glad to tell you." Many people are very willing to tell you who you are. And if we ever fall into the trap of proving ourselves to other people because we really want the attention and we want to be liked, we want to fit in, but at what cost? At what cost? And oh, the stress of it. When I was in high school, I played high school baseball. It was very difficult for me because my dad was a minor league player. And my dad was rather distant. Not that he didn't love me. My mother took so much care. He didn't have a lot of time for us. And I tried so hard to prove I was my father's son that every bat was agony. It had its own agony. It had its own stress. For if I did not do well, I felt I failed in proving I am my father's son. And we all know that feeling of trying to prove ourselves to somebody. And oh, what a stressful life it truly is. Whose attention is it we're looking for? Who is it that we're trying to appease and to gain their attention and to be somebody in their eyes? Who is it? Who is it? There was a dear woman in our life, a very spiritual woman. But we noticed a pattern in her life. And one day I asked her pastor about an issue. I said, "Where does she stand on that issue?" And he said, "Oh, she's a product of the last person she talked with." That's the worst thing that can be said about us. It means I have no anchor. I'll say whatever it takes to belong, to prove I belong. What a way to live. Did you know when Gail and I in our early Christian years married, you know how many things were suddenly wrong that we were told to abandon to prove we were faithful? You took all the owls out of your house. Anybody remember that? Owls were used in an ancient way to denote spiritualism, totem. And Gail had macrame, beautiful owls in her little figurines. And they want us to take them all out because somehow the devil will use them in our home. And then there was put no flowers on any grave, because flowers were used in ancient times to ward off evil spirits. And you're participating in a pagan religion. Don't put flowers on the grave. Those are two of, I can't tell you how many things there were that if you are a Christian, you'll do this and you'll do that. It's the most confusing thing for us as young Christians. How do we live for Jesus? We needed to be asked the question, what does Jesus think of me? What does Jesus ask of me? Jesus took me as I am. He gave me the ability to recognize good and evil. And I'm on a journey of learning more and more about that. But the more I depend on somebody else to tell me who I am, to prove myself to them, I am in trouble. For it's at the root of the temptation. The root of the temptation. God help us if we're still trying to prove how spiritual we are and how we fit in here and there. Choice is to make the decision knowing who we are. And sometimes we'll fail. But we're not abandoned. We're forgiven. We learn. And we move onward in life. Now, what Jesus was being offered was not bad. What was wrong with bread? Just turn the stones to bread. After all, you've already gone all these days without eating. I think that's enough for God. I don't think God will be displeased. Sacrifice your desire for the eternal for that which is so fleeting. Because Jews customarily fasted. Just give up a little short. Turn the stones to bread and prove you're the Son of God. And Jesus said, man shall not live by bread alone. He knew who he was, and he knew who we were. Why don't you bow down? And I'll give you the kingdoms of the world. What greater way to prove yourself as the Son, the special one of God? It can be in a way that can be demonstrated. And first of all, the devil didn't own them to begin with. But Jesus said, no. And he quoted Holy Scripture and reminded Satan that he did not engage in proving himself by buying into power, the quest for power, and to be seen in a particular matter. He goes to sleep at night knowing who he is, just as we should. Toss yourself down from the height of the temple. After all, and now the devil quotes scripture and says in the psalm, oh, the angels will come and sustain you and protect you. That's true in the psalm. It said that in prose and in poetry, not as a test to prove who you are. Thou shalt not test the Lord our God. Jesus never fell into the temptation of proving who he was, and neither should we. If we are the age that I am, and I'm still trying to prove myself to another, God help me. God help me, because the worst decisions I have ever made in my life trying to make somebody else think highly of me when it went against the grain of everything I was. Now, we were all adolescents at one time. I spent my entire adolescence probably just like you, trying to fit in here and there and be like there. And then you graduate and you suddenly realize all those people now are gone. And now there's a new group asking this and asking this. And when I became a Christian, you take a breath, a sigh of relief and say, Now I no longer have to try to prove that way. And then you have Christians saying, if you'll do that, if you do that, you'll prove whether you're devout or not. All temptations are really there in the one statement. Again, who is it we are trying to gain approval from? Christians can be tough on each other. We are important to each other to encourage each other to be our God-given self, to recognize the gifts in each of us, to embrace it, not to try to find that which could be a lot better to prove you're really a Christian, that you do this and you do that. I was standing at a Salvation Army place, and I was buying an old Bobby V album. Anybody remember Bobby V? I think he had a song called Red Rubber Ball. And I had bought an old, I love to collect old albums, and I was up there paying for it, and I laid it down, and there was another cashier. And she asked the man there, she said, oh, is this your album? He said, oh, no. I only listen to Christian music. And you could hear the woo, the spirituality. And I was being made to feel guilty for buying Bobby D's rubber ball. We're hard on each other sometimes. We request of each other instead of helping each other find out who we are in Christ. Jesus knew who he was, and thus he answered with truth. And there was no way Satan was going to divert him from that knowledge. From that knowledge. As I said, he'd return later, just as he said, at a more opportune time. In Gethsemane, this is the great prove yourself moment. If you're the Son of God, just run. God protect you. Fight. God will protect you. Certainly don't accept it. If there's any way this cup can pass from me, you hear Jesus listening to the temptation, and then he says that. That comes from him knowing who he is. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. And that is what leads to resurrection and new life. And a life that at the end there is contentment. And knowing you are you and you belong to God who made you to be as you are. We often conjecture about what God is going to ask us when we face God in eternity. I have to believe one of the questions we may be asked is, why were you not you? I made you. Special DNA. I gave you gifts and graces. Why were you not you? Because you're precious and you're beautiful and you contribute something no one else can do like you. I've had men in my churches that could put up tables at family night suppers better than anybody. They never had to ask to be down there. That was their job. They understood it. They were happy doing it. They were not great with other things, but they could put the tables together and stand back and watch as everybody sat down and feasted around the Lord's table. People do all kinds of little things that don't gain attention, but if they know who they are, they're fine. They're fine. I've had in my churches the keeper of the toilet paper. I've had people that guarded certain things to make sure the church always had them. I had ushers that nobody else was taking their place because that's the job they knew, and they did it. They weren't ugly. That's their thing. Don't ever fall for prove thyself. God already knows who you are and has already desired a life for you you can't imagine, neither can I. For eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor has it entered into the thought of anyone what God has in store for those who loved him. In closing, who did Jesus pick? Fishermen, tax collectors, an adulterous woman, his mother, ordinary, common people. And said to them, you are somebody. And that was enough. Let's pray together. Oh Lord, there are so many who will define us in a moment, label us in a moment. In Jesus Christ, you revealed our worth. The soul felt its worth. You revealed to us that we mean something. We contribute something. Give us the strength to make our choices based on who we know we are in you. And then one day we'll hear what Jesus did. Well done, my good and faithful servant. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen. Our final hymn is Because He Lives. Let's just do the first and the last, Steve, Harold, just the first and the last.
Bye.
you leave this place, go in utter confidence that you were created for God's good pleasure and will, and God sees what you cannot and loves you as you are and knows where you can go. Trust in God. Trust in yourselves and trust in those near you who encourage. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen.